My name is Compost, but you can call me Trash for short. How's that sound? All right, here we go. Terry, if you don't mind, we'll have the lights dim just a little bit. Composting is what? It's a matter of decomposition. It's a matter of decaying. It's a matter of taking plant material, the once alive stuff, if you will, and creating good, sweet-smelling soil. So, Mary told you how to use it. I want to tell you a little bit on how to make it. However, seems like you all know, or most of you know how to make it already. But maybe there's a tip or two in here that would help, and maybe you can try a second type of composting. Here we go. What are the benefits? Oh, to me, the first one is the most important. That's the dollars. That's why I usually wear green, because I like the color of money. So, you see, we can save dollars by doing our own composting. We don't have to go out and buy. So therefore, that's very important to me. It makes us feel green because we're conserving the earth's resources, which also brings me down to conserving water. And my job is Florida Yards and Neighborhoods, Florida-friendly landscaping, and so that's part of it. We need to preserve our natural resources and, in particular, our river. So there are several types of compost methods. I'm not sure what you're using. I can tell you what I use. And let's just quickly mention, there's the batch method. We'll look at that a little closer. The ongoing method, we'll look at that a little closer. Then you can actually compost with no container whatsoever. Do you know that? Yeah? You can compost in a black garbage bag. You can take some leaves, some twigs, and some moisture and throw it under one of your shrubs and just leave it there. It's going to compost, right? It's going to do its thing. Isn't that what nature does? The leaves that lay under the tree, isn't that the most wonderful compost that you've ever had, never seen? Okay. There's also trenching. So trenching or post hole. It's called post-hole composting, where you're going to dig a hole and you're going to bury the trash and the compost, or the sheet composting. You wouldn't use food waste in the sheet composting because you're going to lay organic materials out in your garden, and that way they're going to compost there, but you don't want to use the food waste. Then the heap-like pile. This is a way that you can do it, but really you have the problem with some of the creatures that could come. And in my neighborhood, we get raccoons a good bit. So the heap-like pile is where you just take the stuff and pile it up, even take your kitchen waste, pile it on top, but you always want to be sure to cover it, because if you have food waste, you're going to have creatures come. Now, I have creatures that I actually have at my house that like to take care of things like this, and it's called my dog, Sadie. Okay? Then there's the vermicomposting, or the reg wigglers. And Mary has already told you a little bit about worm tea. She's pointed out Kay, who's one of our special folks on handling the worm tea. And then we're using the red wigglers, so we're going to see how to make that. How many of you are doing the vermicomposting? Okay, not as many, but maybe today we can convert a couple of you. Because it's simple. It's really simple. The one thing about the composting, and now we're talking about what I would consider outdoor composting, because the vermiculture, I kind of consider that as an indoor compost, and I'll show you how we do it. But the outdoor composting, you need to select some kind of a container or some kind of system. And there are several things that you can choose from. But the critical mass is very important when it comes to a compost pile. You see here it says 3 by 3 by 3. Okay, some people think, all right, if 3 by 3 by 3 is the ideal size for a compost pile, then I'll just go ahead and make it bigger and make it a 5 or a 6 by 6 by 7 by 8. And that way I don't have but one compost area in my yard. Is that a good idea? No. Why? It doesn't heat up, does it? It doesn't heat up. And one of the things that's so important of composting is, as far as what we're looking at, is you want it to heat up and it needs air. It's very important that it needs air. So the critical mass is important to have the ideal size or something close to it. Now, here are some choices of containers if you want to put your compost in a container. Isn't this a unique idea? These are homemade. Now, you can either get the grandkids to turn the compost, or here, look at this, used tires. I thought that was pretty clever for a do-it-yourself, right? Has anyone seen that one before? I found that on the internet, so I just thought I'd share it with you. You see, these are all the manufactured, or you can go to the store and buy, or you can make your own compost bins out of pallets. You can make them out of wire frames. You can make them a single compost. You can make them a multi-bin compost. Now, I have to tell you, the multi-bin compost does not suit me because it's too much work. You realize that if you have the three-bin compost, what you put in this first one, you have to pitchfork out into this one. Then you have to pitchfork out into this one. Then you pitchfork back because that's the way you're aerating it. That's a lot of work. I think we can do the same thing, at least in my house, we can do the same thing with less energy, my energy. So you can choose whatever area and type you like. Here's your tumbler, which the more you move in a compost pile, the more you aerate it, the faster it's going to become finished. Location is very important for your compost pile. Also, I want to mention, if any of you are in an HOA, you know you have restrictions on things like rain barrels and compost piles. So you think about that. But if that's not a concern, you still need to think about, where do I want to put it? You want to put it somewhere in the back, of course. It doesn't need to be so much that it's in sight, that it's going to be unsightly, or it's going to have creature access. But it should be level ground, and it should be near water, because you need to have moisture. That's one of the key components, is moisture. Select your ingredients. I'm wearing a few, as a matter of fact, if you hadn't noticed, that is. Select your ingredients. Now, there are two types. You want your carbons, and you want your greens, your browns and your greens, your carbons and your nitrogens, and this gives you, and this is on your handout, a few of each. So when you're going to layer your compost pile, think about two parts to one part, two parts of brown to one part green. Please, please avoid all cooked foods, meats, oils, any of the human, dog, cat manures. Other manures are okay, but not those. Is there anything on this list that seems unusual? Is there anything that I'm wearing that seems unusual for a compost? The dryer bag. The lint from your dryer can go in the compost, and this is the dryer sheet that can go in your compost. So you see, there are things out there that you haven't thought about. So the ideal, again, ideal. We want to get close to ideal. Isn't that how we pick out husbands and wives, girlfriends and boyfriends? We want the ideal, even though they're just close, but not completely ideal, right? So here's our ideal, would be a 30-to-1 ratio. Now, that's not by volume, that's by chemical composition, because all organic material has both carbon and nitrogen in it. It just depends on the amount. So to get the idea, ideal, here's an example. If food scraps are 15-to-1, your grass clippings 17, and your brown leaves would be 60-to-1, then how you would figure that out is add those up and then divide by the number of materials to get an average. So this average comes to 31.1. So somewhere between 30 and 50 is good average for your compost pile, for your layering of your carbon-nitrogen ratio. There's also a secret ingredient. I think in the last speaker, Mary, you heard something about secret ingredients, didn't you? Yeah, so you see, some of the things that Mary told you are secret ingredients that you can use in your compost pile that are considered activators. So if your compost pile's a little too slow, then you can add some activators. Oxygen, most important. I already mentioned oxygen being important. If you don't have enough oxygen in there, you can get some foul odors. So the way you want to do it is you want to turn it a little bit more often, And if it's, for example, I use the wire, just the chicken wire, a good bit, and I stick a broom handle in the middle and just stir it like you were churning butter. Of course, some of you don't remember doing churning butter. Keep the moisture consistent. That's very important. And the way you want to know if it's the right moisture level is to take that handful and squeeze it. And as your picture shows you, you don't want it running down your arm. You just want it to be moist. So the moisture percentage, 45 to 65%. There you go. Now, what's happening inside the pile? You may not care as long as it's working for you. I put this on here for those of you who think you might get on Jeopardy someday. And so therefore, it gives you additional information because you see, we talked about heating up the pile. And the pile doesn't go from 0 degrees to 130, which is a pretty good ideal heating number. But it, But you see, it starts, we have these microbes in there, and Mary talked about microbial activity. The microbes are in there, and if you want to consider, I'm not even going to try to pronounce them because I don't know that I'll get it right. But you have your cooler temperatures, and what they're doing, they're starting to heat up the pile, then your moderate temperatures, then your high temperature. Now, the high, thinking about the temperature, the ideal temperature to heat up your pile would be about 130 degrees. 125 to 130. You see, if you get higher than that, you're actually killing off the good microbes that are doing the work for you inside of that pile. So it doesn't have to be steaming and setting on fire, but that's how you get the temperature coming up is with these microbes inside and these creatures inside. So check that temperature. Just make sure it's not going over 130 so you're not killing the beneficials in there. Now here's where I said we would talk a little bit about the two methods, and that is the batch method or fast, hot, fast method. You can have compost in a shorter amount of time, and this says that it can be ready in 1 to 2 months. Well, with the hot, fast method, it'd be like the tortoise and the hare, okay, and the ongoing method, the tortoise and the hare. This one would be which? The hare, okay, because it's going to go fast. But with the batch method, that means that you have to have a lot of planning because you need all of your materials stockpiled. Remember, we need the carbon-nitrogen ratios, but you need all the materials stockpiled because you are going to complete that compost bin, pile, however, all at one time. You're going to complete it at one time, and it's going to finish at one time. So that's why this takes planning. It takes extra work because you need to tend to it on a regular basis. And I think I have here, you need to be stirring that, stirring, tumbling, whatever your method is, stirring, tumbling, so that you're aerating. And the, remember what did I say about the more you aerate, the faster it's finishing and the more it's working for you and it's helping to heat it up as well. So you see, depending on you, what you want and how fast you want it, as far as the batch method. This is more me. This would be the tortoise. The ongoing method, where you're not going to have compost as quick, 3 to 6, 3 to 8 months, or up to a year. In my house, it's about a year, because I have more than one compost going at a time, and I use the bins that's similar to this, because it's just the lazy person's way. When I get something, I put it in there. So what I am collecting for this year, I will be able to use next year. So it for me, you know, a year is not too long for finished compost. But you will have less effort. And if you're not going to stockpile everything, then that's really what you're doing, is you're going to have the ongoing method. Now here, it won't get as hot. And so it may not kill the weed seeds as the batch pile does, because the batch method with that heating is going to kill most of your weed seeds. Just don't overheat so that you kill the microbes. So in a nutshell, the pros on the hot is finished quickly, it uses space efficiently, it builds fertility quickly, and kills most weed seeds. But the downside is you have much more labor involved. And you need to certainly control the carbon, nitrogen, and the moisture. You need to keep them at ideal levels. Build it all at once, store the materials. The pros on the cool is little maintenance, and you just add a little at a time. I mean, it's the slow, let's not be stressed over a compost pile method, you know? That's why I don't look too stressed, I guess. So the cons would be it takes longer, it doesn't kill the weed seeds, and you may have bits in there that have not decomposed. There may be some bigger pieces. Is that the end of the world? No. Because when you're actually harvesting this one, then just take those pieces that haven't completely decomposed and do what? Add them to the new pile. Boy, Terry, this was a smart class. I told you it would be. So is it done yet? Now's the time to harvest. The batch method, you're going to harvest all at one time. You started all at one time, so it should finish all at one time. So you harvest it all at one time. But with the ongoing method, you're going to harvest a little at a time, you know, from the bottom corner here, there, because that's how you started it, and that's the same way you finish it. You harvest it a little at a time. Now, how do we use it? I think Mary has told you pretty much how we use it. But I want to share with you, she talked about worm tea, but I want to talk just a half a second about compost tea and show you an idea that we can use, we can use as far as making large amounts of compost tea, and not just small amounts to spray on the plants, but making a large amount by taking a shovelful of finished compost in a 5-gallon bucket. And this is the Evi version. Here we go. I use this idea. Now you have to, this is my litter box, and just imagine this is hooked to your spigot, okay? This is hooked to your spigot. You have in here your shovel full of compost, so that should be heavy, right? Should be heavy. And then you think if that water, oops, I'll fix it. I made it, I'll fix it. So the water is coming in and then it's coming out. It's circulating up through the compost and it's coming out. And with the length of hose is entirely up to you. That way you don't have to carry the bucket if you just had a short nozzle on it. And if you want to spray a large area, Mary, thinking of you spraying your vegetable area, just like you were doing, Kay, this could be a little bit better than just using a small idea. So this is in your handout. This idea came from the Rodale Book of Composting. And I didn't have a 55-gallon bucket. What I had was the kitty litter, which is clean, dry. Yes, ma'am. Well, you're using the tea, you're making moisture, and I mean, thinking of even houseplants, when you're going to be using the compost tea for watering, you're watering the plants. I mean, you can do what you're saying, but this is considering you're watering your plants instead of watering just your plain water. You're actually watering with the compost tea, which has all the wonderful nutrients. Does that answer it?
Yes, I was thinking.
You were thinking two things, okay. Yes. That's very beneficial, yes, to use the rainwater. If you are.
If you use city water, you will kill the microorganisms.
Use your rainwater, and that's excellent. Excellent. I'm glad to hear that you're saving rainwater, because that's another one of the Florida friendly ideas. But by putting the shovel full in there, and the water is coming from your house and circulating through, you see. That's diluting it. If I just took it and I wanted to put it in a container to spray, I would have to dilute it, yes. Yes, okay. All right, so that's talked about how to make compost. And I need to tell you real quickly how we can do vermicompost, and that's with our worms. And so we're using the red worms. The red wigglers is what we use. And it's very simple. This tells you about the worms in case you get on Jeopardy again. You never know what the categories are going to be. So this will give you some idea. But what your considerations are when you're doing the vermicompost is, what are my goals? What am I trying to achieve with these worms and the castings that worms eat and expel their weight every day? And that's called the worm castings. So what the worms need, however, they need darkness, they need a container. These are the containers that we use in our classes, these black dish pans. We have vermiculture classes, well, make and take workshops, we call them. So we have the dish pans, that's darkness, the bedding, and we use in our classes the shredded newspaper, food. Food is any kind of the food scraps, and we have another slide on the food, some of the food items, but the raw veggies and the coffee grounds, tea bags. Moisture, again, moisture is more important than food to these guys because they even eat their bedding. Air is very important. And their ideal temperature would be about 65 degrees. So that tells you they like the same air conditioning you do, and they like the same, I guess, heating in the wintertime that you do, instead of being in a hot garage or a cold garage, somewhere like that. So what are your goals? Real quick, how much maintenance do you want to have? For example, and this hurts my heart to say this one, if you want to have worms for fishing. Now you see, I just don't like anybody to tell me they're doing this because they want fishing worms, because I name them. And when we have workshops, we even sometimes hand out birth certificates. So, but if you're interested in fishing worms, that's a high maintenance level, because you're going to harvest in 2 to 3 months. If you want your castings for plants, you can feed them and leave them alone for a period of time, and they're going to develop on their own. And then if you want continuous worm supply and castings, that doesn't take much effort either. I find that it's very, very little effort to have worm compost bins. So choose a container, as I'm showing you what we use in our classes, and it's a great starter bin. And actually, I have about 4 different size sitting out. My office is just outside the door here of worm bins, and I have used all different kinds, and I like these just as well as anything. This is a picture of several different ones that I have used. You can make your own, or you can buy something. Add the bedding, as I said, and when you start, just have moist bedding. We use shredded paper. You don't have to buy a shredder. You can tear it up by hand. The worms don't know the difference. And moisten it. Put that in there, fluff it up. We make about a third of the dishpan full. Then we add to the bedding a little sand, some crushed eggshells maybe. See, eggshells help keep the pH in tune. And also, you can add sand, or you can add a little peat moss, anything, because the worms don't chew, but they have a gizzard like a chicken. I don't know who figured that one out. But they need the grit. That's what we're doing. They need the grit. Now, add the worms. And we're using, as I said, the red wigglers. There are others, like the brown nose worms, you will have heard other people use. But we find that the red worms, they're smaller, and they multiply much faster. I mean, 15 worms could be 1,500 within 6 months. It doesn't take long. Here are a couple of sources. This is a local source. However, you still have to go online on her website to buy the worms. But so as far as a local source to get worms, I don't know. When we have our workshops, we put in their starter boxes maybe a dozen worms. And I've never bought a worm, and I've been teaching these classes for a good 10 years and started with about 8 or 10 worms, and they just multiply that fast, and it works so well. Add the food. The other thing about the food, you want to bury it because you don't want to have any extra sour flies or fruit flies or gnats. Now, I read that some places say you don't need to cut up the food for the worms. Well, you don't. Terry's a proof of that. She puts hers in there whole. She puts whatever's in her hole. I chop mine up because they don't chew. They slurp, and so I figure the smaller, the quicker they're going to be able to get to it. But her worms eat it. My worms eat it, so you do whatever suits you best, okay? And I call it wormarizing if you have a food chopper. If you have too much food, you don't want to put too much in, you know, go slow to start, because you'll get foul odors and you'll get all sorts of fruit flies. And if you have extra food, just fix it up and put it in little baggies and put it in the freezer till they're ready to eat it. Now, when it's time to harvest the bin, remember, depends on the maintenance level, because you're going to harvest it a little sooner if you're doing it for fishing. But method of choice is, there's two methods, and these little guys, but you can lay a plastic out, and for example, if we were going to harvest this bin, lay a plastic out and then dump them all out, pile it up and put a light on top, and they'll all go to the bottom, because they don't like light, remember that. They don't have eyes, but they're sensitive to light, and they'll get paralyzed in about an hour if they get too much light. So just start scraping off a little at a time, okay? That's one way. Another way is you can feed in one corner of the box or the bin, because they will make their way and they like to migrate toward the food, okay? So it's a slower process, but it works that way. So some of the uses, Mary has mentioned some of the uses for the worm castings. This I find to be interesting, that Ohio State Research has given us this information about the germination. And the worm tea. Now, we talked about compost tea, but we also can make worm tea. So if you were going to make a whole lot of worm tea, you could still use this sort of setup with your garden. And it's also been told that it's great for black spot on roses. I don't have roses, that's another story. Now, troubleshooting, if it's too wet, here's another idea for you. If it's too wet, take some of your silk stockings. Not everybody has stockings. Fill it with peat and then just lay it in your worm bin, and it'll soak up the worm tea, and then take that out and put it around whatever plants or in your garden, wherever you want. We had this happen before, and that's why this I thought was kind of a neat idea. And you see, another thing I have to tell you about the girls in my worm boxes, they like to dress up. So you see what we use for covers, okay? We use that for covers to hold the cover on. Anyway, got to keep going. Here's another thing. As far as the other critters in the pile, they need to live there too. So they are also helping you to do what they need to do. But some of the critters that you get in the pile and outside of the pile are your fruit flies, your gnats. And so therefore, you have them sometimes at home, don't you, on the counter? Let me tell you how to take care of that. And let me show you some proof. If you will take a small dish and some cider vinegar or vinegar, I don't know that cider, they might like balsamic, and a couple of drops of dish soap. I had this sitting on my desk, and those are the ones that they jump in, but they don't jump out. So that will take care of them. So try that at home if you have fruit flies or gnats. It works. So these are the guys who are in that bin, that worm bin with you, and also in your compost pile. So they have their own board of directors, and so they've called a meeting to say, we're happy to have all of you here today, and here's some resources for you. Haven't seen you around here before. Don't be silly, I'm your other end.